Okay, we'll get started. If I can have your attention, please. Thank you so much for coming. On behalf of the archives at NCBS and the campus, I welcome you all to the 21st edition of the Archives Public Lecture Series. For those of you who are new to campus, we run this public lecture series once a month. There's a sign-up sheet going around. Please do sign up if you'd like to be on the list. You'll get about 4 or 5 emails a month, nothing more than that yet. Maybe that'll change in the future. If you've not been to campus before and it's the first time hearing about an archive, we have an archive here on the campus set up as a space for the history of contemporary biology in India. I do encourage you to please come visit the archive after the talk if you have some time, or any time going forward. We're open Monday through Friday up to 6 o'clock, and on Saturdays and then Sundays by appointment. The easiest way to reach us is just to send us an email, archives@ncbs.org, and you can go look at the website up. This public lecture series has been going on since March 2018. And it's been a small attempt to try and just get people from different communities to speak to each other. We're very, very fortunate and glad to have Usha with us today. Usha's talk is titled Body Politic, Politics, A Recent History of Technology, Databases, and the Human Person. I'll give a brief biography. Many of you in the audience probably know her work and probably are familiar with her work, especially related to issues around biometrics in the last decade or so, but we're talking about a 4-decade sort of inquiry and sort of introspection around legal issues, and especially around questions around the databases over the last couple of decades. Usha works on the jurisprudence of law, poverty, and rights. She researches rights and speaks on issues that include the nature of law, the Bhopal gas disaster, mass displacement, eminent domain, which we'll be discussing today, manual scavenging, civil liberties including the death penalty, beggary, criminal law, custodial institutions, the environment, and judicial process. That's a lot. She's been tracking and engaging with an Indian National ID project and has written and debated extensively on the subject. She has been writing and debating issues of technology and the human conditions of freedom and liberty over the years. She was a member of the expert group on privacy set up in the Planning Commission of India, which gave in its report in October 2012. She was a member of the committee in 2013 and 14 set up by the Department of Biotechnology to review the draft human DNA profiling bill in 2012, and we had a discussion about that a couple of days ago. She was a member of the committee set up by the Prime Minister's office also to study the socioeconomic status of tribal communities, which gave its report to the government in 2014. And in 2019, this year, she was awarded Access Now's Human Rights Heroes Award. She's been an extraordinary resource, and she's been extremely sort of gracious in offering her time over the last few days, talking to students on campus and others who have been coming around. So thank you so much, Usha, and over to you. Thanks.
Technology is not my forte. Sorry, I couldn't do this on my own. Can I move this? Look now.
Okay. I forgot to mention, which I probably should, there were two other alternate titles that we thought of for the talk. One was to think of poor jokes in IT. She's pretty good on that, we should ask her. And the other one was how to live in India without a cell phone. So
the second is rather easy. Just throw out your phones and you'll know how to live. Actually, perhaps you live when you throw your phones out. The first I'll try and avoid today. I can't promise though. Or maybe I should start with one. So there's a cruel joke about this scientist who was experimenting with this frog. And he was, there was a frog, and then he plucked one leg off the frog and told the frog, before he plucked it off, he said, jump. And the frog immediately jumped. Then he plucked off one leg, and then he said, jump. The frog tried a little, it was obviously painful, but it jumped. Then he plucked off two, and I'm sorry about the cruelty, but it happens in labs right here. Then the second leg was taken off, and he said, jump, and it struggled. Then he said, jump again, and then with a real effort, it managed to jump. He did that with the third foot too. And after the third foot, it was really hard, but it did jump. Then after he plucked off the fourth foot, he said, jump, it wouldn't jump. He said, jump, it wouldn't jump, and the, you know, it kind of crescendoed, and it still wouldn't jump. And then he had this, he wrote his report up saying, when you take all the four legs off a frog, it goes deaf. What you're going to hear today is actually very similar to what happened with this. The kind of experiment that is being done, the kind of hypothesis that was first placed before us, and the kind of conclusions drawn from what was seen is not very far from what this joke tells us. You figure it out for yourself, because I'm not going to say much more than that. But I do want to say why I felt that at this time it was particularly useful for some of us to come in and have this conversation in a community of scientists. Part of the reason is because the world is changing in dramatic ways. It's not just changing, it's changing in dramatic ways. And for me and for some of us as constitutional lawyers and people who are concerned with how the law and constitutional development is occurring now, and it's, you know that it's occurring in multiple ways, so this is not the only one. We've seen that in the past 10 years, there are certain basic things that we had taken as a given about our lives, which are being questioned, which are being subjected to very deep questions. Actually, it's not even being, it's being uprooted. There are efforts to uproot this. In our learning of the Constitution, we've had one of our best constitutional minds who's no longer with us now, but who taught us a lot while he was around and continues to teach us through his writings, K.G. Kannabiran, who was our civil liberties lawyer, and an extraordinary constitutional lawyer. He gave us a little bit of understanding. We understood a little bit. Although he gave us a lot. He explained to us how this is a constitution that has fundamental rights. And when you have fundamental rights, you also have what are called reasonable restrictions. That, you know, no right is absolute, but it is the right that is fundamental and not the restriction which ought to be fundamental. And that's a huge shift. You know, if we think of rights as being fundamental and restrictions as being superior to rights, in a sense, that, you know, after you've had all your restrictions, then you can have whatever is left over as rights, we're inverting the Constitution. So he had taught us that it is rights that are fundamental and restrictions are the exception, and restrictions need explanation, not rights. But what has been happening over the years, and it's not just come with technology, but what's been happening over the years is that the, you know, slowly with an erosion of the idea of rights, and with us also giving up a lot of our rights by not exercising them and not demanding that they should continue to exist, it is the restrictions that have become fundamental. And the rights have become what is left over, which we then exercise with permission from various authorities. And this has been a dangerous path down which we have walked over the years, and it's suddenly got speeded up. It's like we are not able to recognize our fundamental rights very easily anymore. The second thing he told us was that it is a very hard, arduous journey from being a slave to becoming a subject, and from being a subject to becoming a citizen. And it's not like once you become a citizen, you can just take that as a given. You have to work really hard to keep citizenship going. It doesn't, it's not like once you have it forever. There's no eternity to it. You have to work at it. And we are finding now that this way of thinking about our constitution that he taught us, where our constitution was to help us establish citizenship in each of us, and that we move away from being subjects of the state and become citizens in our own right, that seems to be under some form of, I don't like the word threat, so I won't use the word threat, but if someone knows a synonym, kindly provide that, because that's what it is. It seems like some of it is vanishing from, you know, from our midst. So what I'm going to do today is just, you know, we had the UID litigation till last year, and till before the UID judgment was delivered, and prior to that, before the privacy judgment was delivered, there was a certain way in which we talked about this project. It still seemed that, like, there were certain open spaces, and those were the spaces that we were agitating in. After the judgment, things have changed, and it is remarkable the ways in which things have changed. So I just thought, for us to figure out where we are today, we get a little bit of a glimpse of where we've come from, and we take some kind of a hypothetical step into the future to see where we might be headed. And that's what I'll try and do today.
The first thing is that in the past 10 years, you'll find that there were some truly dramatic statements that were made to us. One dramatic statement that completely changed the way some of us were thinking about the relationship between the state and the people was when the Attorney General went to the court and told the court that the people of this country have no right to privacy. Soon after that, we had many people tell us, you know, the people of this country really don't care about privacy. You keep saying privacy, it's just your elite concern, but nobody else is really, really cares about privacy. What we found was that it is true that nobody had concerned themselves too greatly about privacy, except in the context of surveillance. Other than that, you know, where you have phone tapping, then you worry about what privacy means. But other than that, we didn't really talk very much about it. It is when this statement was made that we realized that why people hadn't talked about it earlier was because there was no need to talk about it. You had privacy, you negotiated it in various ways. You didn't feel you were losing it, so you didn't have to fight to retain it. But we found that after the Attorney General made the statement, there are many Indian languages in which there isn't a convenient and comfortable word for privacy. And that was because we didn't need to create that language. And when we read 1984, we understand the meaning of language. You create language because you need it. And if you want a thought to go away, all you need to do is to destroy the word. If it vanishes, then it's very difficult for us to think of it, think of that word, you know, what the meaning is that that word carries. So the word privacy, we didn't need to give it any deep meaning because it was there and we didn't feel that we were losing it. And there were many other things that we were battling with and battling for. But the moment the Attorney General went in and said that the people of this country do not have a right to privacy, we found that there were, in every state that I would go to, people were trying to find what word would fit to describe privacy. So in Tamil, I mean, I'm from Madras, and in Tamil we really struggled because we had things like antarangam, which is about, you know, inside and connect. Nothing fitted. And then we found that this is a time for the production of language. Sometimes you have to find a language because what that language speaks about needs to be preserved, and therefore you need language for it. Otherwise you don't always need language. So for those who've read 1984, maybe it would be interesting to see what the new speak, you know, the idea of new speak in 1984 did. And for those who have not read it, do read 1984 for a range of things, but do see what Newspeak does for us. Newspeak, in brief, is where there is a whole department that is sitting within Big Brother's government, which is trying to shear off language, shear off words. You keep on taking words out. And after a while, you know, for instance, if you have the word good, you don't need the word bad. Because bad conjures up images which are not very good for people to think about. So you make it not good, the image in your mind will still be good. And it's only that it is not that, but you don't have a word for what it actually is. In the women's movement, we often say that, you know, in the 80s, when violence against women was becoming a huge thing, and all of us were concerned about it, there, you know, many people would tell us, what are you complaining about? You know, it is mothers-in-law beating up daughters-in-law. So it's all among women and between women. So what is the problem? And it used to confuse us too, because we knew that wasn't quite what the problem was. And then somebody dropped a word in our midst, patriarchy. And then we said, now we know what our problem is. So there is a way in which language gives us a way of understanding a concept, and there are times we need to create language so that the concept remains in our midst. And privacy was one such, especially in terms of Indian languages. The second major statement, the second dramatic statement that was made by the same Attorney General in the court was when he went to the court and said, what makes people think that they have an absolute right over their bodies? And at that time, we thought it was some kind of a weird rhetorical statement that we all had a laugh about. But over a period of time, we've learned that that wasn't just a flourish. That is a question that's seriously being asked. What makes you think you have absolute right over your bodies? And of course, putting in absolute into that sentence makes it seem like there could be some logic in it. But what the statement was actually doing was taking away the right that you have over your own body and saying that it belongs somewhere else. It is the right of somebody else that they have over your body. This came in the context of biometrics, saying that you need to give your fingerprint and you need to give your iris. And it was because the income tax law had been changed to say that you have to link your UID number with the income tax returns. And so people were saying that I don't want to give my biometrics. Why should I have to be forced to part with something that is mine? And the Attorney General came there and said, what makes you think it is yours? So it's a question, it shifts a lot of ways of our thinking about ourselves, about our relationship, not just with the state, but with our own bodies, and with what belongs to us, and what perhaps we ought not, you know, what we're being told we ought not to have control over. The third thing is something that we are seeing open out in our midst now. If you open the papers today, yesterday, pick up all these papers, you'll find the state saying, we have a legal right to launch surveillance over our people. So there is a, you know, in law, you provide the state with a certain kind of authority for a range of things, including surveillance. So there are, but you can launch surveillance when there is a reason for why you're launching surveillance. It's not a blanket power. It's not a power that's just being given to the state saying, okay, whenever you want, now we've made a law. You can do what you want. Wherever you feel it is necessary for you to launch surveillance, you may carry on with it. That's not what the law says. But the law is now being interpreted to say that since we have the authority to surveil people, we have a blanket authority to surveil people. We will decide where we want to surveil them. We'll decide the manner in which we want to surveil them. This is an extraordinary moment. The fourth thing is about this idea of something called the rule of law. Rule of law is a much contested concept. It's not like it's very clear what it is. But this much is certain, that we are talking about, when you say rule of law, we are talking about various kinds of powers being held in, being reined in by the law. And law doesn't have to be just legislation made by parliament, but by the idea of the rule of law. So nobody can have, like they say, we can't have absolute rights over our bodies. Nobody should be able to have absolute power. Power has to be mediated through various kinds of things, because as people, we give some parts of our power to the state and to various agencies of state, and we allow them to exercise it on our behalf. So it has to be contained within that. Now the rule of law has been taking a severe beating. It's not just now, it started it's constantly tightrope walking. But in the early 90s, the idea of governance came in and took over the imagination of many governments. It's not just the Indian government. Many governments have took over. And the idea of governance became being able to achieve what the state sets out as its targets. And the World Bank, for instance, has been instrumental in changing the meaning of governance in this way, where they say good governance is about being able to achieve the targets that you set. So never mind what the human cost, never mind what the cost to communities, never mind that you might have mass displacements, never mind all those things, but you've just got to get, otherwise, you know, how are you going to make your economy grow? So the notions of development and growth that we have around us requires a certain meaning to be attributed to this thing called governance and to this phrase called good governance. Now this is the kind of framework and at a time where we are now. It's also a time, interestingly, when we notice that the richest people in the world have changed. And that's actually quite fascinating. In the last century, you'll find that there were pharmaceuticals, there were some of these, you know, big companies who would, you know, like Walmart today is among the richest companies. But the richest people and the richest companies would broadly also have at least five who would be from the oil world. So oil ruled the last century. From the beginning of this century, you find that has changed. And if you were to go and check on almost any list, you'll find that 5 to 7 of the richest people in the world today are people who come from the technology world. And that too is interesting, because when you think about the number of things that we get free from technology, it's amazing that anyone makes money on it. So how are they making that money? And how do we learn to ask that question, and where do we go seeking that answer? So that's become an important question because of what we've been through. In the past 20, 25 years, we've seen the world move more and more into the world of technology, you know, information technology to begin with. But actually we started like many other countries have done, with digitization. We had computers and we had digitization. And digitization proved to be somewhat efficient, less problematic, more easy to maintain records, and it was hoped too that it would reduce corruption. So the classic thing that we used to be told in the 90s was that the introducing computers in railway booking brought down dramatically the kind of problems that there would otherwise have been in booking, you know, because you could skip queues and you could keep hold back tickets and you could sell them. And so this was, and because people moved by train quite a lot in the, you know, till then, it was something that really mattered. And the kind of ease that it brought, I think many people appreciate. There was a certain anxiety at the time that it was brought in, that it would be displacing jobs, that, you know, it would be doing things that we don't yet understand. But then it turned out to be all right, and we've carried on with digitization. Now, digitization is not just an isolated process, as we've learned over the years. We find that in the early 2000s, it shifts. From digitization, it moves on into ID systems. So the ID system concept starts getting discussed in India. First, we had the voter ID. And when the voter ID came in the 90s, there were many of us who were deeply concerned about this, because the idea of the voter ID was that every adult who's entitled to a vote should get themselves onto this database, should allow themselves to be identified by the Election Commission and will be given a card. And for those who work in various, you know, on various kinds of issues of poverty, impoverishment, and induced vulnerability, we know that the, you know, those who are in various conditions of poverty live in a twilight zone of legality. And they need the shadows, because the system doesn't work for them. The system works for us, it makes us legal. What we do becomes the legal norm. But where the poor live is not how the legal norm gets constructed. So we were worried that this kind of, you know, sunlight on them wouldn't be a disinfectant, but sunlight would actually prove to be a huge problem for people who are in that condition. But when, what we found, however, was that the voter ID didn't harm people. In fact, it helped them, because many of them found for the first time that they had a centrally issued ID. And especially in the context of homelessness, we found that people were able to show that, you know, I've had this voter ID since, you know, with all the cutoff dates that many of our schemes have, this helped in establishing that they've been there from, you know, from before then. So it was fine. And we learned, our suspicions kind of subsided and we let it pass. Which is why when the UID came in, there were many of us who thought, okay, they're giving the poor a card, they're enrolling them, they're allowing themselves to be able to identify themselves. This is interesting. So it is not with suspicion that we stepped into this arena. But the project is something different. So we now see it as a continuum where digitization puts everything in electronic format, which makes it accessible definitely by the state. In the 2011 rules under the Information Technology Act, makes anything that is in e-form, in, to be, the state can ask for it and get it. And then we find that they move from that into this ID system. Now the ID system is an interesting kind of phenomenon, because it came in at a time where there were many problems in this country, but the problems were, they were there in the late 90s and early 2000s, which were improving already because of other systems that had come in. For instance, the PDS. The public distribution system was in a crisis in the late 90s and early 2000s. And the right to food, people who worked on it were agitating with the state. There was a huge case going on in the Supreme Court at that time. And that's one of the cases that has actually produced an improvement, that has helped produce an improvement. It did not do it itself, but with the help, you know, the Supreme Court too was able to assist in the production of improved systems so that the PDS would get improved. But the PDS was then used as an excuse. The failures of the PDS system was used as an excuse for bringing in the ID system. So just in brief, you find that after the Kargil War, the Subramaniam Committee is set up, and the committee suggests, because that was about the failures in the intelligence, failures in intelligence which led to the Kargil War. And they say that if you were able to give IDs to people along the borders, it might help in quickly identifying people and not having to wait to find out whether they are from across the border or not. And That then slowly the TCS is given the task of producing a report on how you would do such an IG system, and it's the first time that you find that two things come in. One, that you can use biometrics while making this ID system. And the second thing, that once you've got an ID system of this kind, it should be capable of being used by the government and the private and commercial entities. So it enters, because it's these entities that are going to produce, that are going to help produce the technologies which will result in making an ID system possible. In 2003, you have this Citizenship Act that is amended, and by then, without any real serious explanation, we've moved from the fear and threat of the militant from across the border, which was towards Pakistan, to the illegal immigrant who was coming in from Bangladesh. And so they talk about having a national register of citizens and rules being made under that. Those rules have 15 fields which we are supposed to contribute to so that they can enroll us. And that is the first stage, which is the national population register. And those rules do not say anything about biometrics. Then in 2006, Wipro comes up with a report after a planning commission meeting where you hear about an ID system. So the problems are about TDS and ration, and you don't find that at all in the report. What you do find is, how will you use this to create an ID system? And the two words, that the two notions that become very important in that report are the notions of ubiquity and universality. So in that report, they tell you how through the short, medium, and long term, you will get everyone, that is universally, everyone should be on that database. And everyone should have that one kind of ID. And how do you achieve it? By ubiquity. That is, you demand that it should be put in every database. You don't allow people to function unless they're going to be putting their number in every database, and people will have to get onto the system. And you find that that is what the UID becomes later. The UID is brought in 2009, and in the notification that sets it up, there is no mention of biometrics. But there is a mention of something that many of us caught on to in the beginning, and that was that the UIDAI would maintain and own the database. Now, in our relationship with the state, there are many places where we interact with the state to give the state information. We expect two things. One, that this information will be held in different silos. And the second thing is that the state is only a custodian of that information and not an owner of that information. We find that quickly starts changing. The idea of ownership of this data becomes important because we see the relationship between the state and business interest shifting into a different gear at this time, and people becoming something else. I'll just pause here to say that in response to the many things that were said before, including that there is no right to privacy, there is, you know, when the challenge was taken to the court in 2012-13, the basic argument that was being made was that, you know, the Constitution is not about the power of the state over a people. The Constitution is about the limits of the power of the state over a people. And the state taking power over a people is the exception, and not the people asserting rights in relation to the state. Now, this is a very fundamental understanding of any constitutional dispensation. If the idea is that we only have remnants which is given to us, which is how the privacy argument was made in court, where they said, no, they don't have any right, but the Parliament can legislate and give them a certain right, which of course Parliament can legislate and take away. These are the kind of rules on which our new technologies were brought into our midst. So we need to know that this has been happening. In this process, some doctrines that have existed prior to the introduction of technologies, of these technologies in our midst, they have acquired a new meaning. One of the most significant among those is this doctrine of eminent domain. It's fascinating because this doctrine of eminent domain is from the 1600s, or maybe 1500s, from Grotius' time at least. When he was talking about it, he said that, you know, the government, the state will have to provide a range of things in the public interest. There is a public purpose for which the state will have to act. So the state should be able to take private land and use it for a public purpose on payment of compensation to the person. If you don't pay compensation, it becomes expropriation. It is not acquisition, and it would be more unjust. So, but the power of the state to be able to take private land for a public purpose was something that was placed in this doctrine of eminent domain. Over the years, in 1894 in India, we had the Land Acquisition Act, which all of you must have heard about because it's been at the center of so much contention over the past 20, 25 years, in fact 30 years. And it's only in the past about 6 years ago that law was replaced by another law, and it's a very interesting law, but that's something for another day. In this idea of eminent domain, the state started acquiring land and started asserting over a period of time. See, the courts were the only bulwark, and they continue to be the one bulwark. They're not the only bulwark. People themselves are the best bulwark against the power of the state. But the courts as institutions are what stand between absolute power of a state and the rights of people. But the court stepped back and said that we will not question this idea of eminent domain. The state does have this power of eminent domain, and we will not question the public purpose. We won't say whether it's good public purpose, legitimate, illegitimate. Largely, we will leave it to the state to decide what it is. So they stopped interfering in it, and the only place that the law and the attitude of the court allowed them to go broadly, because it's over 150 years, there are variations here and there, where they said that we'll just figure out whether you need to be given more compensation or not. That's it. So the power itself became difficult to challenge. And you find that after independence, with the idea of, you know, state, planned development, new models of development that are being thought about, the state starts over a period of time acting like all land in the state belongs to it. You have it till the state wants it back. And that's the battle that has been fought over the past 30 years, saying it's not yours. In fact, in the beginning, those who were battling this, like say in Narmada, were saying that you have this power, but don't exercise it in a way where people lose rights. But then you realize that actually they don't have the power at all. The state is not an all-powerful entity over a people. And therefore the answerability of the state is far greater than the answerability of a people to a state. Now this doctrine of eminent domain, as it is expanded, has over time spilled into water, not just land, but into water, into mineral resources, into forest resources. And you find now something really dramatic is happening, where we are being told that what we are, the person, belongs to the state. And the question that the Attorney General was asking when he said, but you know, this is the, what makes you think you have power over your body, is an eminent domain question. They were asserting eminent domain and the right, the authority to be able to decide how much of what you are they want. This is truly extraordinary, and it's a moment in history which, if we miss and we don't do anything about, we might find ourselves having to struggle really hard to climb back up, even partway. So we do need to recognize this quickly and do something about it. Now, in this doctrine of eminent domain, where they say that we own all your bodies, there are various ways in which this has happened. We had, for instance, something called a right to silence, and I'm unfortunately having to use it in the past tense, because we seem to have lost it without even noticing that we've lost it. What is the right to silence? The right to silence usually arose when someone came and accused you, saying that you've committed a crime. You didn't have to speak. You didn't have to, because if you accuse me, you have to prove that I did it. It's actually very difficult. I think you should do some exercise sometime to see whether it's possible to prove the negative. How do you prove that you did not do something? You know, in the UID legislation, there's an interesting thing where they say only residents are entitled to enroll for a UID. And they say there that you have to be a resident, you should have been in the country for at least 182 days. In the preceding 12 months before you apply for your UID, for enrollment. How are you going to prove you've been here? I can prove I was not here if I have a passport and I can show how many days, markings. How do I prove I have been here? Just give it a shot sometime and think about what these kind of prescriptions mean. So this idea that the state owns us and the state owns what we have and that we, by the way, are the new resource. Like land was a resource for development, like water was a resource for development, like minerals are, like the forest has been. We now, and when I say we now, it means the kind of data that can be generated from us becomes the new economic resource, which the state wants to use to be able to build businesses. Now, this is not some great hypothesis that I'm doing. It's not a conclusion I'm drawing either. It is something that's been said to us. We just need to learn to listen, learn to hear it. Like when the Prime Minister went this time to the US, he told the business, the business people there, he said, they say that data is the new gold, new oil. I say data is the new gold. It is cheap in India. Come and invest. Now this is, and when they say data here, it's all about personal data. They're only beginning to talk about non-personal data, which by the way is not really non-personal. It's just that it's being said something in the public domain is no longer personal. If it belongs to a community, it is no longer personal. If it's anonymized, it is no longer personal. So it is still about personal data. Personal data about each of us has become the next big business. And we need to understand what the implications of this are. We also know that, it's actually fascinating because one of the things that we've been watching unfold over this period is the number of databases that are being created. And I just want to rattle off a few and maybe talk about one or two of those. We all know about the UID database. It wants everybody on it. It has demographic information, which by the admission of the UIDAI itself is actually all over the place. And so they say that we will have a self-cleaning mechanism, which means that you have to go and clean up your own data or your ID won't work for you. So that is one kind of database that has been created. The second is the National Population Register. And I will not refer to the National Register of Citizens yet as a database because it is something else at this point. But the National Population Register was very clearly intended to be a database of people. Then we have something that's coming up, and it's before the Parliamentary Standing Committee now. You have a bill that's being discussed on DNA databasing. And DNA databasing is fascinating. It's kind of gone through from about 2003 to now. It's changed form in some ways. It started off as something that the Department of Biotechnology and the CDFT in Hyderabad worked on together to produce a bill. And the idea was that there will be various indices that will be created. There will be a DNA data bank which can be used for multiple purposes. Which will include, the kind of things that it will include is offenders index, there will be a suspect index, under trial index, missing persons index, unidentified dead body index, and then volunteer index, and any other index as is prescribed by regulations. And regulations will be done by the DNA Regulatory Board. And at that time, the DNA Regulatory Board, the chair, the secretary would always be the director of CDFT. So it was never made clear to us, and I don't think we still know, what were the kinds of things for which this index was intended to be used. Because the CDFT does do a certain amount of forensic DNA testing, but it's not the central agency to get into issues of policy relating to forensics and DNA. So we don't fully know what. But we do know that in the changes there were a lot of, there's a lot that happened between, say, 2013 and 2016. I was a part of that, so I'm going to kind of jump through the hoops without actually showing you the hoops and tell you what the position is now. Because at that time, we had already said that you cannot use databases of this kind. You can't database people, and then you can't, and the UID was also rolling out at that time, so you shouldn't be having this UID being attached to this, because that will mean that you're making us all transparent and insecure. And you cannot hold all these, you can't use it at all for civil purposes, in civil disputes. Because in civil dispute, in criminal law, they've taken away choice in many ways. And we've had one of those which are not sufficiently contested areas in criminal law, is the idea from 2005 that you can be compelled to give your DNA, your blood, your serum, your sputum, whatever else. And that you don't have a choice if you are a suspect in an offense. Now that idea that, that when you take something from my body, it doesn't infringe my right to silence because only the voice speaks and the body does not, is something that hasn't yet been debated sufficiently, and we don't, you know, it hasn't gone far enough in that. Now in the latest version of the bill, they have some extraordinary provisions. So I think, you know, as scientists you need to know it, but also as people who might be going to a lab for some purpose, you might need to know it. All DNA, all labs that conduct DNA tests of any kind will have to be accredited. And every lab that is accredited will have to contribute the DNA profiles that they create to a regional DNA data bank and to a central DNA data bank. And you won't, you're not even informed because it is by the law. And it is not, you know, if I'm a suspect in a case and they take my DNA and put it on that database, I can ask for it to be removed. But there is no procedure provided here for DNA which has been taken from these, from the various DNA banks, from the various DNA labs and put into this database. So we have an extraordinary thing where our DNA by law is going to be taken and put in databases and put to multiple users. And when you look at the schedule to the act, you'll find the kind of uses to which it can be put. All of you might have heard of the N.D. Tiwari case. Now, the common thing is for us to feel a certain kind of chuckly, not disrespect when it is a politician. And I think that's how it was when the N.D. Tiwari case was going on. No one really took it all that seriously. But the case was that an adult, a grown-up young man, wanted it to be firmly established that N.D. Tiwari was his father. And by all circumstance, you know, the question of access, there are in law, there are various ways of presuming paternity. And all those presumptions could be raised in this case. But he wanted it to be unqualifiedly established that N.D. Tiwari was in fact his father. Now, actually, in law, it can't be done. In the sense, if I refuse to give my DNA in a civil case, they can't force me to give my DNA. You can draw an adverse conclusion, but you can't force me to give my DNA. But that is how we understood the law till the court said, no, no, you have to give. The Delhi High Court said, you have to give your DNA. And if N.D. Tiwari refused to cooperate, they said the police can come in and hold him down while they were drawing blood from him. This is truly extraordinary. And to my mind, it's not something that should ever be permitted, however you feel about it. Now that will no longer be necessary. Because if you're on that database through whatever means, if you're on that DNA database, they can just do a search, a keyboard search, and find out whether this person is in fact, whether it matches or it doesn't match. And that's enough. So your choice of allowing your, you know, your body parts to be used for determining whatever it is that, and I was asking, suppose they had established through this DNA test that he was not the father, then what? And you find that there's a recent case where they say, well, if he's not the father, then pay compensation of 1 lakh. It doesn't change anything. You've still violated the body of the person. So there is a way in which all these basic standards are getting eroded. And if we don't stop it, it'll vanish. These won't exist. So somebody can come and take, you know, you might have somebody claiming, for I might have someone claiming that I have a stepbrother who nobody knew about. And a court can order, which by the way are questions that are raised by lower judiciary members, who say that, can't I ask you to give your blood because your father is already dead? And we need to establish whether this person is your stepbrother or stepsister. Can't I compel you? Can't there be, you know, compulsion by the court for me to give my DNA? I'm not involved in any way. It's my father. My father perhaps had another child. Why am I being brought in? But I can be compared. So this manner of treating the human body is something that has become common. And the DNA bill basically says we don't need any of that. We'll just database you and we'll take what data we want from it. It also scares the hell out of me that this bill has a provision for pedigree, for testing pedigree. In these times, this is not a very comfortable place to be. It also says that it can be used during immigration and emigration, DNA. So why a law would authorize something like this, and why we wouldn't ask for explanations? Even if there is a good explanation, we need to be given the explanation. Many of these things are happening. Like the DNA happened through marketing, this is happening through the coercion of the law. And none of us seem to know how to ask those questions. The UID itself brought something fascinating. It brought in biometrics as a means of identifying people. Initially, when it started, we thought it had to do with providing us with an ID that we can use. But very soon we realized that this is not about our having an ability to use an ID. It was about us being identified by a system, because it was never about, if any of you is using your UID card, I just want to, you know, introduce a little uncertainty into your lives and tell you that such a thing doesn't exist. It's just a letter of intimation. And you'll notice that there isn't even a signature of an authorized person. So it's not even an authorized card, which is why you can download it, you can have it in black and white, you can do what you want. What it is really is a number attached to a biometric. Now you would think that when it is an, so if you think that for a number to be attached to a biometric and for that to be an ID, the biometric should work. And the system should have known that the biometric will work before they made this the basis of ID, of identity. You find, strangely enough, that in 2010, 2009, December, there was the first Biometric Standards Committee report. In 2010, the UIDAI issued a notice for a consultant, an invitation to a consultant who could come and create all the protocols, in which they say that they actually know nothing about whether biometrics will or will not work in this country, whether fingerprint and iris will or will not work. But they are encouraged that it will work, and therefore they are going ahead with it. Now I just want to say this, that yesterday we had a discussion where we, I was able to explain the whole process by which we have now been able to, we are now able to assert that biometrics do not work like they are said they will. And just to give you one illustration in the law, let me not just say it, one illustration, there are two things that have happened. One, we've seen that a large number of people are getting excluded from the ration system, for instance. And it's fascinating that in a new system that has been introduced in our midst, including the Supreme Court, which has said that all people are equal, but some people are less equal than others, and therefore the poor don't need the protection from being on these databases. If you want, you know, your benefit and your service and your entitlement, then you have, you know, the poor have to be on this database. The poor are finding it hardest to be able to use their biometrics, because from the beginning it was recognized that fingerprints especially, it would be a problem if you're a manual laborer, if you're working with chemicals, if you're in hard places where there is a lot of dust, the kind of place that you live in, all of this counts for biometrics. And that to me is plain common sense, but it also stands established now. So there are many people who are getting taken out of the system, and there are, you know, like the three words unique, ubiquitous and universal, you have another set of three words. Actually, there are a number of three words. I just want to go back to that unique and say that when we are doing biometrics now, in the beginning, all of us thought that it was biometrics that made this unique. I'm sure many of you here thought that too, that, you know, it's because of the biometrics that it's a unique number. But then we realized that, no, it didn't have anything to do with biometrics, because they actually didn't know whether biometrics would work or not. It might work to a certain extent when it comes to enrollment, but to authenticate the person and over a period of time, it is not possible to depend on biometrics. So what is it that they then do depend on? What does it mean? What is it that's unique? And you find that actually one of the early documents that was produced was a document called UID, a numbering scheme. This is about numbering the population. Each of us has a unique number, not unique biometrics. Biometrics still remains in that same place where it was. I'll just say this, that in 2015, there's a whole history to this which I won't go into, but in 2015, the Supreme Court, after having said that UIDAI should not give the biometric database to anyone or give any biometrics to anybody other than within the system itself, in 2015 August, when the question of privacy came up, there was one clause in that which said that if a court orders, you have to give biometrics to them. If a court orders, then the UIDAI has to share biometrics with whoever the court orders you to share it with. The UIDAI has always been very chary about sharing biometric data. They've never been willing to do it. And as far as we know, and we've been following it quite closely, at least they've never admitted that there has ever been an audit, an independent audit of the system. So you find that in 2015 August, there is an addition to the page where you have the UID project being described, and at the end of it, the last bottom of the page, you have something called UBCC research. UBCC stands for UIDAI, Biometric Center of Competence. And when you say, and they were going to do research on it, and in one of their sentences there, they say that they're going to do, this is 5 years after they had started collecting biometrics, and over 2 years after they had started using it in the PDS system. And after failures had begun to occur, which was being acknowledged in the field but not being acknowledged within the UIDAI system itself. Because they kept saying it's not our failure. The failure is if you don't get your biometrics right, you don't get rations. The failure is that you don't get rations, so let somebody give you the rations. But we are not going to talk about the failure of biometrics. So here they say that the nature and diversity of India's working population makes biometrics a challenge. And yet they don't stop authentication by the poor when they have to go in and get themselves their rations. So there is something the matter in this which we need to, and it's not, you know, everybody is not a bad person. There might be a few bad guys here and there, but not everyone's not a bad person. Why is this being allowed to continue? What are the impulses that are pushing for a thing like this to be continued? It's also interesting because we don't have our own biometric companies. We don't have that. We don't have the technology being generated here. So we are having to depend upon foreign companies which are located outside. And because biometrics used to be used primarily in the defense establishment and in the intelligence establishment, the links of these companies with those establishments is very close. So one of them, for instance, is L1 Identity Solutions. And I'm just going to read out a short passage about what Justice Chandrachud in his dissent had to say about L1 Identity and the relationship and what access they had to our data. He says, under the contract that is between L1 Identity and UIDAI, L1 Identity Solutions retains the ownership of biometric software. UIDAI has been given only the license to use the software. Neither the central government nor the UIDAI have the source code for the deduplication. Technology which is at the heart of the program. This is the technology, deduplication technology, which is at the heart of the program. The source code belongs to a foreign corporation. Now, if I were to say it, they'll say, oh, you know, these activist-y types, which, by the way, I'm an academic too, so you need to know that. But the point is, but this is coming from a Supreme Court judge who studied the papers and who, I must also say, when the hearing was on, was initially inclined to just dismiss the concerns that were being raised because he said, you know, people keep complaining about everything, this is a good project, till the only constitutional argument that was made was a PowerPoint presentation. And even during which, the person making the presentation, who was the head of the UIDAI, was unable to answer many of the questions, or the answers were even more shocking than what we had believed before then. But I have to say, unfortunately, is again for another day. UIDAI is merely a licensee. It has also been provided that L1 in the contract, that L1 Identity Solutions can be given access to the database of UIDAI and the personal information of any individual. So when someone tells you that what is this privacy you're talking about? Nobody, you know about me, I know about you, everyone knows about you. And I must confess, the one that really gets my back up is when they say, when you're on the train, you should hear everybody talks and everyone knows everything about everybody else. Actually, I found my imagination is most fertile when I'm on the train. The number of stories I conjure up about myself to tell my co-passengers is not funny. So it's not about breaching my privacy. It is about stoking my imagination. And if people don't know the difference, I don't know what to do about it. But here, you find that this is in the introduction of this technology and the collection of this data from us and holding it at a time when we don't have any ability. You know, we are all talking about data localization. Data localization, because they say, Mr. Mukesh Ambani said it best. He said, we need to localize data so that Indians can have control over their own data, or at least Indian corporations. Because fighting with the Silicon Valley has proved to be very difficult. They are way ahead. And actually, they've been given 10 years here, and they still haven't come up with any great product. So the product that they will tell you is, NPCI, National Payments Corporation of India. But that, again, I'm sorry, is another story. Or maybe I'm not so sorry that it's another story. Now we find that fingerprints, therefore, are problematic, but we never really acknowledged it. IRIS was brought in, and you'll find if you read the documents, and since you're an archive, it would really help if we could find some archive which would document, you know, which would archive all these documents, because we don't want to lose them. This is how it's developing, this is how it's evolving. We find that in 2016, the head of the person who was the mission director of the UIDAI in 2010, he writes a blog in which he says that the biometric standards committee had actually had a problem because fingerprints was not proving to be enough. They had said that they tried it on 25,000 people and they found that 2 to 5% of them did not have biometrics that worked. Their biometrics did not work for enrollment. So you think about what happens when you come for authentication. There are whole stories on authentication, which again, I'm not going to tell you anything about now. But he said, they pressured the biometric standard committee to adopt IRIS as a standard, although no tests had been done on it. So when it was decided that this would be adopted, they did not know if it will work, but they had reason to doubt that it would work. So the fact that they have got such a vast database is actually remarkable, given the kind of problems that there are. And it is not remarkable at all that there are so many failures for people who are being forced to use it. Where it got clearer to us was when, after demonetization, in 2016, December, the Vattal Committee report had a member of, you know, who works on the UID system with Mr. Nilekani. And they had said in their report that they did not want to use biometrics as an authentication, for authentication. They said, we'll use some other two-factor authentication. So which is where we come to JAM. All of us know JAM, right? You know what JAM is? Yeah, I know. No, not that JAM. Not what you have with butter. You butter up people to get into JAM. So that is Jandan Aadhaar Mobile. So in 2010, Mr. Nilekani had given an interview, and he's the chief spokesperson, so he will keep coming back again and again in our conversations. He had given an interview saying that roti, kapda or makan is now passe. What is relevant now, what's important, what everyone will want to have is a bank account number, a UID number and a mobile number. The UID actually cannot work without a mobile. If your fingerprint stops working tomorrow, which it will, then for you to re-enroll, the only way, how will they know that it is you if your fingerprint is not working? So the only way they know it is by sending an OTP to your registered mobile phone. So if you don't have a mobile phone, or you have a mobile phone but you've not registered it, or if you changed your number, what do I say? So as a, there are a few things that I just want to say before I wind up. The first thing is this, that I would request that we revisit the idea of using a conjunction between science and technology. I'm not sure it works. The second thing is that when I say the rule of law has been a problem, it is about this idea of innovation. The difference between discovery and innovation is something that we might need to spend some time on and understand what it is. And in innovation, innovation is something that the technologists have brought in, where they're saying we're creating new products. Now, if you're already going to put all kinds of limits on us, we can't create new products. So you keep your constitution aside, you keep your rights aside, don't tell me privacy and all that. Let me create my product. Then we will make the law to fit the product. That's what's happened with the UID itself, and that's a good illustration. When the Supreme Court, without understanding, you know, the Supreme Court validated, four judges actually validated the project, and you can see that they've had to struggle, you know, it's like they've done copy editing of the legislation to make it constitutional. Some 28 things, if you change the word here, if you make something else there, no court ever does it. So that you can see that there has been an extraordinary effort by the majority of three judges to find a way to make it constitutional and to allow that law and that project to continue. But even they felt that, okay, we'll keep it to the poor and we'll keep it to Section 7, and then the law is valid, now let's worry about the rest later. Don't send it to too many other places. So what they did was to say, not for banking, not for mobile phones, Because you're all being told, go and put your UID number in your bank account or it will be freeze it. And if you don't give it at all, you'll never get your money back. If you don't put your number in your mobile phone will stop working. And that means, you know, in UID parlance, it's like civil death. So if you can't have your mobile phones with you, right? So this threat saying that you need to do all of this was the way in which this project kept getting promoted. And all, finally, the court said no to banking and no to mobile. The first thing that came after the judgment was the government saying, don't worry, we'll make a law which will allow you to use it. It just couldn't be done in the money bill, we can do it in another bill. We'll make sure that you can use it. Then it was introduced in the Lok Sabha with the last government. They couldn't pass it in the Rajya Sabha before the end of that session. So they introduced it as an ordinance, which, by the way, is truly extraordinary and remarkable. You do not use the idea of an ordinance. An ordinance is for an emergency. And what the emergency was in allowing private companies to be able to access a public database of this kind is completely unexplainable. And then finally they passed it as a law now. So the last thing I want to leave you with is this, that what has happened in this period is we've seen the closeness of relationship between the state and business interest. The state has been told in 2011 in a report called the TAGAP report that it has no ability to deal with the amounts, vast amounts of data that they have. And therefore, there should be private companies that are set up called National Information Utilities, where the state can have a minority share, but private industry will have a majority share. And these will be natural monopolies, but that is how you're going to process all data. They will service the state and then make money off it on their own. The Goods and Services Tax Network is such a national information utility. And just go back and keep watching to see what happens with the Goods and Services Tax Network. And the very last thing is this, that the idea that our data can become somebody else's property is something that should at least have been discussed before it was taken over. It was not only not discussed, it was introduced in 2012 in a policy document. On sharing data, every department was told that whatever data you hold belongs to you. It's your property. And you can decide what you want to do with it. So the state has now said, and with the Shri Krishna Committee coming in and the economic survey this time, the Mr. Nilekani said it very nicely. He said, this is about trickle-up. Our economics is now trickle-up economics. Why? Because we are a data-rich country, but an economically poor country. People don't have money to bring to the market, but they have something that business wants, which can then become the Indian economy, which is personal information. So your personal data will trickle up, and that will become the new business. And that will become the property of those who hold it. This has entered all fields. If you look at the national health stack, you'll find that they say there that India has the maximum. They say we are going to have the largest, vastest warehouse of data on health because all Ayushman Bharat is fully going into this, into the national health stack. So this health stack, all these stacks and the applications which are being created in these stacks are being done by people who used to work earlier with the UIDAI and then stepped down saying that it's easier to work from outside. If you're inside, you have to work with RTI, with, you know, when CAG will come in. If you're outside, you create these products, evangelize them to the state, and then they will become the platforms on which we can build our data businesses. And since the very last should never be the very last, I'll just say one more very last, which is that artificial intelligence is not new. Many of us started with reading Isaac Asimov when we were kids and were terribly excited by iRobot. So we know that it's existed, but why did it go into a lull? Because artificial intelligence requires an enormous amount of data. It will grab at any data that comes in from anywhere. All these systems which are being created through the coercive use of the state and through what is seemingly a free service that's being provided to us, these are the things, this is a kind of data which is being chewed up by the system to create artificial intelligence. So it's the interests of the world of artificial intelligence and of those who want to build businesses on data that this complete change in our constitutional status and our right to be the kind of human beings we want to be, that's being put under a challenge because of these ambitions of data, artificial intelligence, and the kind of businesses it can provide. With this, we move from being citizens to becoming subjects, and very quickly objects. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Usha. We have time for a few questions from the audience.
Thank you for the speech. My name is Hemant. My question is that, if we look at it, there are several databases that are being created. So the idea is this, they do take consent while they're taking my biometrics or a fingerprints or whatever, or even my mobile number, but it's not being I don't get the consent when it is being used for some purpose. Let's say I'll give an example for a criminal case. They're using some of my biometrics or whatever, even my identity as simple as caste or where do I live. Are there any legal provisions against for me to protect myself as an individual? Because my identity has been recorded digitally somewhere else where the state can use to act against me.
So there are two adages that have emerged in this period. One is that privacy is dead. That is a necessary part of this new technology coming in. It can't come unless they can assassinate privacy. So it's being made like the new common sense to believe that privacy is dead. We know it's not, but you know that's one of the things. So many of your questions, therefore, they would treat as redundant. The second thing is that consent is broken. So there's no point of thinking about consent. You have to find something else. So there can be some kind of restrictions that a state can bring in, but broadly you have to allow for all of this to work because anyway privacy is dead. So when you ask, are there any protections? What we've seen in the past 10 years is something that we've not really seen in this way before. Even when the state went berserk, when they had POTA or they had TADA and they wanted to assume all those extraordinary powers, they passed a law which gave them the legal right. It may have been something that we might ethically, morally, constitutionally challenge, but they gave themselves the legal right. In this you find that the way they've tackled it is by not making the law. If you don't make a law, then something is not an offense. So if they pass your data on here, there, whatever, so the limited amount that you have in the information technology law and the limited amount that you have in a few rules made under it is all that you have. In relation to the UIDAI, they were to share it. And I just want to say one thing because they keep confusing this question that we raise. The UIDAI does not retain all the information about our banking and mobile phone and this and that. Our problem is that it links up all these databases, making it easy. So among the various databases, I mentioned a few. There is CCTNS, which is Crime and Criminal Tracking Network System. There is NATGRID, which is the National Intelligence Grid, which has also been in the news quite a bit recently. There is this extraordinary thing with the health records of armed personnel, where they found that they've been wanting forever to attach the UID with it, and one Commodore Lokesh Batra has been waging a battle against it, saying, and to me it seems right, 57 lakh people, their data is now easily available to anyone because they had a private vendor who came in who was handling all this data. And he's walked away, now the department doesn't know whether they took it back from him, whether he's still, whether he continues to have it. In 2018, December, in Parliament, they said, we are going to check this, and they still haven't. Now, why I'm specifying, why I'm focusing on this is because if they haven't managed to secure the health records of armed personnel, and remember that health records is not for armed personnel, is not only when they fall ill. Every time they have to have a checkup, that's going to be part of their records. And this information is so lightly available around, and they haven't managed to take any steps on it. I wouldn't give you too much hope on your, on the privacy. But we do need to build in structures of liability. We need to build in limitations on what can be collected. That's the first thing. And this convergence of data through making it possible through things like the UID has to be broken. Otherwise, there's it's not only personal security that's at stake. National security is very clearly at stake, except I don't think the government understands the technology, so they perhaps don't get what the problems are. sometimes one should be charitable. Yeah.
Sorry.
Take
one more question. Go ahead.
What does meaningful... Yeah, I wanted to know, what does kind of meaningful resistance or protest culture look like to you in, you know, especially with something like, say, Aadhaar? Like, what can one do? Because it's very easy to be helpless.
No, it's actually not a choice to be helpless, unless we are planning to give up all the freedoms that we have. And it's also, okay, what does it mean? The first thing is, I think we should stop allowing people to market our liberty to us. When people tell us, this will become easier for you, just come, all stand in line, give me your fingerprints, give me your, and then you will get many things. That level of naivety first we have to drop. Because, you know, you can't tell a corporation not to be interested in profits. But you have to tell a people not to be naive and gullible. So we have to learn the distinction between fact and marketing. And that's fundamental. Second thing is, when we see something is wrong, we've got to speak out. That's why, you know, the whole point of the freedom of speech was that we speak. But what I find has happened very often is people will resist. They keep saying, I don't want to do it. I don't want to give this. I know that there are problems with it. What to do? Income tax. So I've gone and given it. And then they stay silent. So you have not asked any questions after that. The Supreme Court judgment had said that anybody who wants to exit the system, other than the poor were completely counted out of constitutionalism by the Supreme Court, by the majority in the case. But they had said anybody else who wants to exit the system can exit the system. Till today, UIDAI doesn't have a procedure by which you can exit the system. And it's over a year. And nobody has even tried. Institutions, how many institutions have we gone to tell them, UGC says that we won't give you any more money unless you're going to give, you know, everybody. So it's not just them. Every person there, everyone teaching, everyone, every student, every adjunct faculty, every, you know, clerk, whatever, everybody there. If you don't give it, either they'll lose their accreditation or you'll lose your job. You go to them and say, once ask them under what authority of law they are doing this. Throughout the period from 2013 to 18, when the judgment was finally given, the government was in deliberate violation of the orders of the court. So all we said was, even to law institutions, said, just write in and say, you know, we respect what you're asking us to do, but we are bound by a Supreme Court order. And the Supreme Court has said, we can't mandate it. They didn't even write and ask. So if we are going to take our liberty as something that has to be given to us by the state, then they will give us what they want to give. So there are multiple ways in which we need to be, first we need to recognize, understand, make it our business to know. These are things that are fundamentally changing our lives and we can't afford not to know. And then to be able to write, to speak, to challenge, to assist. You know, to assist, when the Election Commission in 2015, when they pulled back on this voter ID and UID linking, it happened because the case was taken to the court and it was one of the contempt applications. But the person who was advisor to the Election Commission heard what was happening and then asked for help and said, what is this? Explain to me. Why is this a problem? You have to be there to do that. So we need, it's not enough to know that there is a problem and feel uncomfortable. If it's not okay, see, that's the point about, you know, when people say activists, academic, this, that, I say, actually, I've not had a job on any of this. So the thing is about active citizenship. Because if we don't practice active citizenship, then there will be none left. And we can, there are others to blame, but we've also missed the bar, you know, missed the boat in that thing.
Thank you.